know that everything in government is upon your shoulder. We ask him tonight, oh God, that you rule over everything. Oh Lord, every congressman, every congresswoman, every representative, the White House, to the court, we ask you, oh God, to shield the mind as they make decisions concerning every county, every state, every city in your son Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you tonight for keeping us and sustaining us. You know, God, I'm asking right now that everything that's not like you, that you step in, hallelujah, and that you, oh God, be a shield around us. Oh God, I'm asking right now for your covering over every candidate that is represented here on tonight, that you will guide them, lead them into all truth, that you will direct their path. Oh God, I'm asking right now, anything that's in the way that could block their thoughts or decisions, oh God, I'm asking that you enlighten their spiritual eye, and that you give them the thoughts and the plans that you have for us as a city, as a country, as a nation. In your son Jesus' name, I thank you right now for being in our right mind, for being alive today, to be able to vote. Thank you, oh God, for every open door and every door that you shut that no man can open. We thank you, oh God, for healing in our bodies. Thank you right now, Jesus, for Pastor Sabrina McKenzie, the clergy, and everyone that has put this together. We thank you right now, and we are depending on you, oh God. The thoughts and the plans that you have for us are good and not evil, to give us a future and a hope. We still hope in America. We still hope in this country. We still hope in this city. We hope. We have a hope. And no one can take that away. Lord, we forever give your name the glory, the honor. Lead us, protect us, speak through us, help us with every decision made for the government. And we ask this in your name, we declare the decree to be so. Amen.
Now that we have heard our prayer, we have entered into his days with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. Let us stand up on our feet and just worship him a little bit. Amen.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him.
church, to the synagogue, to all the community of faith, so that they would know what is being decided on as it relates to the community of faith. So I'm so happy because tonight your presence tells our politicians, it tells our leaders that the community of faith is concerned and is engaged in public policy. Oh my, my, my. Thank you, Lord. I would be remiss if I did not thank all of the people who helped make tonight possible. We have so many wonderful organizations who have worked tirelessly to make this event be so. And if you're here on tonight, I would like you to stand. Pavement Blue, I'm going to call your organization, and when you hear the organizational name, please stand.
present, and we're going to read their bios so that as we are going through the program, we don't have to stop and introduce them again, okay? So if you would please stand, Dr. Rashad Ritchie, dear friend.
We're here tonight.
appreciate all of you for being here, because this is what is democracy is all about. And we appreciate it. We're glad to be a part of it. We will continue to fight. You know, the NAACP is nonpartisan, but we believe in the power of the vote. Thank you very much.
son. She has the most amazing radio voice. We also have two representatives that came in today, or tonight. Representative Erica Lee, would you please stand? We want to acknowledge your presence tonight. And the president of the NAACP Cobb chapter, Mrs. Deanne Bonner. Representative Mitchell, are you here? That's my representative, and even in his absence, I want to acknowledge him because he helped us put this program on, and he is one of, I believe, one of the greatest representatives in the state of Georgia who is able to work both party, beyond party lines, and is just very approachable and allows us with the Legislative Clergy Council and the National Task Force Against Domestic Violence to serve at the House of Representatives regularly, to the point that, so much so that sometimes we get on their nerves. But we appreciate all that you guys do. In his absence, Representative Jones, would you mind standing and reading the bio and introduction for John Ossoff? I would love to have a representative do that. Awesome. And is he present? Is Theron here? Theron?
Good evening. Can you hear me? Okay. I'm Representative Sheila Jones. John Ossoff was born and raised in Georgia and grew up here in the 6th District. Today, he led a company that investigates corrupt politicians and organized crime. His team has taken down traffickers, exposed dozens of corrupt officials around the world, and uncovered atrocities committed by ISIS in Iraq. Previously, he was a senior national security staffer in the U.S. Congress, working with our military and intelligence community to keep Georgians safe while investigating wrongdoing by government contractors. During 5 years as a congressional aide, he learned how to get things done in Washington, D.C. On Capitol Hill and as a journalist, he learned how to expose and fight the abuse of power. He will use his experience and all of his energy to fight for Georgia. I present to you John Ossoff.
And raised in Metro Atlanta. I grew up in North DeKalb County. Went to Georgetown University School of Foreign Service, where I studied international relations, had the privilege of studying under former U.S. Secretary of State Madeleine Albright, studying under Michael Oren, the former ambassador of Israel to the United States. Worked on Capitol Hill for 5 years as a congressional. giving an extraordinary amount of their time and energy. And I recognize and I remind myself every day that this has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with the times that we are living in, the kind of community that we are and that we seek to be, the kind of country that we believe in, one where basic standards of kindness and decency and mutual respect are upheld, where our elected representatives uphold them. Where a focus on working together to get things done and accountability on the part of those who represent you are the highest priorities of those seeking elected office. So thank you all for that engagement. Now the eyes of the whole nation are on Georgia's 6th District right now. It's no exaggeration to say that the eyes of the entire world are on this community right now. So what I suggest is that we stand up in this moment and we make a statement. We make a statement about those core values and how they unite us here, on our commitment to moving beyond our petty differences, to moving beyond politics of fear and anger and division and us versus them, and instead focus on getting things done together and improving our lives together and building a better community together. And thank you again for having me. I look forward to the questions. I appreciate it.
So now you know why being a college DJ works out. We can go to the soundboard and get the mic working for you. Well, John, thank you for coming out today. All right, as mentioned earlier, my name is Dr. Arthur Vaughn. I'm going to start us off with questions, and then we'll wrap it up with an additional set. So these questions were intended for both candidates, but we're going to go ahead and go through them. And how long for each question, Madam Timekeeper? 3 minutes. You know, we're in church. We got to make sure we tell people how long they can talk. All right. So the first question, what is your commitment to diversity and how will that be reflected in your local and DC stats?
I hope you won't mind if I join you in standing, just so everyone can. All right. Thank you for the question. As I mentioned in my opening remarks, it's been an inspiring and uplifting thing to see every community in the 6th District and across the metro area getting involved in this campaign. And I believe that our diversity is a strength. I believe that for a congressional office to be accountable to every community in the district where a member of Congress represents, the staff has to represent the diversity of that community. For the efforts of an elected representative to bring greater opportunity and investment, more capital and clients for businesses to every community in that district, it's important that the staff reflect that diversity. And I have been so honored to be invited into your homes 3 or 4 times a day, 30, 40, or 50 people coming out from most of the neighborhoods across the community. And it's been a testament to our ability to come together that those crowds have represented people from all walks of life and all backgrounds. And I think there are many in this community who haven't had the voice that they deserve in Congress. And what I have committed to them is that if I'm elected, their voices too will ring out in the halls of Congress, that my door will always be open, and that I will celebrate the diversity of our community, and that it will be reflected in how my office is staffed and run. Thank you.
So to move to the next question, what have you done and what will you do to restore the Voting Rights Act?
Well, the campaign is running a robust voter protection program with poll watchers and attorneys ready to defend the right of everyone in this community to make their voices heard on the 20th and during early voting, which of course is open now. When it comes to the Voting Rights Act, I'll be candid, I don't have great confidence in our new Attorney General. And I do not believe, with all due respect, that he has demonstrated over the arc of his career the kind of commitment to voting rights and civil rights that we should expect from the nation's top law enforcement officer. So, oversight is a key role of the U.S. Congress. Holding federal agencies and federal officials accountable to their obligations to enforce the laws on the books, to enforce them in a way that represents the interests of everyone in the United States. And I was just at a early voting rally a few hours ago with Congressman Lewis, whose skull was fractured more than half a century ago, marching across the Edmund Pettus Bridge, standing up for his right to vote. And I will join him. I will join him in Congress to hold Attorney General Sessions accountable and ensure that the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act are enforced.
Community policing policies?
Thank you for the question. I think when it comes to law enforcement in this country and our criminal justice system, our priorities are all out of whack. We have high-level organized crime, transnational crime, human trafficking, high-level white-collar crime, financial crime, rape and murder, rampant. And yet we spend billions of dollars and waste so much human potential locking folks up for nonviolent drug offenses. And there are some candidates, I suppose, who are reluctant to discuss it openly, but I'm not. I think we need to set the right priorities. And I will seek to resource task forces at the Department of Justice and at the National Security Council to crack down on real crime that hurts people across this country and around this world, setting the right priorities to keep our communities safe, not squandering the potential of America's young people, and punishing the taxpayer by focusing on the wrong priorities. And I think, of course, we also need the kind of leadership that can bring law enforcement and those they are sworn to protect and serve together in some candid and constructive dialogue to build trust. Because that gap in trust has become a problem. And I believe that we can both honor law enforcement and ensure that every American, regardless of their socioeconomic status, regardless of their race, is treated fairly and properly by the criminal justice system, whether while out and about in their daily lives or at a traffic stop. Or during an investigation, or during prosecution or incarceration. And I will speak up for those in this community and across Georgia who don't receive the respect for their civil rights and due process rights that we are all entitled to. Think again. I think this is an area where most folks see eye to eye, and there is unity in this community to ensure that our laws are enforced, that law and order keep us safe, and that the civil rights of all of us are respected. I see I'm out of time.
So what in your opinion, what is your opinion on Georgia's strict photo ID law that disenfranchises thousands of Georgia voters, even though there was little or no evidence of voter fraud in the state of Georgia and around the country?
Well, I will oppose the cynical efforts of politicians at any level of government to undermine the hard-fought rights of American citizens to exercise their right to vote. It is an open secret that much of this legislation, which purports to solve a problem of which there is little evidence, is cynically intended to result in partisan political outcomes and to disenfranchise Americans. It's an open secret. And as I spoke earlier to holding the Justice Department accountable to enforce the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act, I will hold federal officials accountable and speak out with my voice publicly and firmly against any efforts to disenfranchise voters in this community. I was encouraged that a federal judge upheld the constitutional rights of everyone in this community to vote in this election. And I sincerely encourage everyone to make their voices heard, whether or not they support me, no matter their political persuasion, because this is what democracy looks like.
Thank you.
Thank you.
President Trump signed an executive order that allows churches to engage in political activity with or without infringing their tax-exempt status. Does this mean that churches can endorse candidates? And what are your thoughts on this executive order for clergy?
Well, I think that there is great ambiguity around this executive order, its intent, its implications, and that's part of the problem. What this means in terms of the prerogatives of clergy to involve themselves in politics, I think remains unclear. I suspect that it may have something to do with money in politics. And my campaign is powered by grassroots, small dollar fundraising in average contribution amounts of less than $50. But you've seen the kind of nonsense on the airwaves here the last few months. A lot of that is coming from Washington, D.C. super PACs who are funded often anonymously in unlimited amounts by the special interests who have been dominating the political process for decades. That's why I am committed to campaign finance reform. That's why I'm proud to have been endorsed by M Citizens United. And I will work to get anonymous, unchecked money out of our political system so that this discussion can return to the issues rather than this endless noise that we see on the airwaves today.
Thank you. Thank you. Will you as the new congressman to be completely accessible to your constituency for in-person meetings when feasible and or be responsive to concerns via phone, email, or direct communication.
Absolutely, and I hope my presence here reflects that. I would respectfully ask that question of my opponent. But as I said, I have been out in the community, honored to be invited into people's homes three or four times a day to speak directly, answer directly the questions from those whom I seek to represent. And I will continue to do that if elected. I will hold quarterly town halls open to the public if elected. We have got a whole crop of career politicians up there who are apparently afraid to answer questions from the people they represent. I hope that my presence here today and the kind of accessible campaign that my team and I have been running reflects that commitment to access and transparency and openness and responsiveness that you deserve. We may not agree on all the issues, and that's okay. There are plenty of folks who are volunteering the campaign, don't see eye to eye with me on every issue. But I will be the most energetic, open-minded, and responsive representative you have ever had. I make that commitment to you.
Nearly 700 positions are vacant at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention because of the continuing freezing on hiring initiated by the Trump administration. What will you do to bring these jobs back to Georgia? How will you work to let the current administration know the adverse effects these cuts are having at the CDC, the National Institute of Health, the Department of Health and Human Services, to programs that support local and state public health, emergency readiness, infectious disease control, chronic disease prevention, clinical work, patient care, and more? And if I may add, as the Executive Director of Morehouse School of Medicine, I am extremely interested in your answer to this question.
I held a press conference a couple of months ago with Dr. Jeffrey Copeland, who is the former director of the CDC, which has many employees in the 6th District and indeed facilities in the 6th District. When the original draft of the House's health care bill proposed a massive attack on the preventative health fund at the CDC, this is national security infrastructure that surveils infectious disease outbreaks around the world before they can reach us here, that monitors the level of pollution and toxins in our drinking water. It is a false economy to think that undermining our health security infrastructure is a sound policy. It's not, and it'll cost us much more in the long run when we're responding to crises that could have been prevented. The CDC is indeed a local economic asset, but it is, here in Atlanta, a national asset, a global asset. It keeps people across the country and around the world safe. And I will oppose efforts to undermine that health security infrastructure. I will seek to strengthen it. I don't, frankly, know what's going through their heads up there when they contemplate undermining the systems that are in place to make sure we're aware of avian flu outbreaks, yellow fever outbreaks, Ebola outbreaks, before they enter this country. I think it's nonsense, and I'll stand up for the CDC if I'm elected.
President Trump ran on a platform of being different, saying he is not a politician who would conduct business as usual in Washington, and that he would drain the swamp in D.C. Do you see yourself as a different kind of politician, and why?
Well, I spent the last few years as an investigative journalist, running a company that specializes in exposing crime and corruption. Not because it's lucrative, but because it's impactful. It holds powerful people accountable when they abuse that power. And I think we need a little more of that in this world. I think we need a little more of that in Washington now more than ever. I have not sought elected office before, but as I said in my opening remarks, I think now is the time for some fresh, independent-minded leadership in Congress, that sending another career politician to Congress, you get the same thing you get from all, regardless of party. I don't want to speak ill of my opponent. She's unavailable to join us, but she has run six different times for five different offices. Folks in Georgia have politely declined her services. You elect more of the same, you'll get more of the same.
Tell us what healthcare policy you are proposing for the state with the repealing of the Affordable Care Act.
Well, there are three principles that will guide my work on healthcare policy. First of all, no American should suffer or die from treatable or preventable illness. Period. Second of all, no one should go broke because they get sick. And third of all, no business should have to lay off employees or downsize because of skyrocketing premiums, and they have to all too often. And I think that we can find bipartisan common ground to advance proposals that will get more folks covered at lower premiums with a higher quality of care. If policymakers will commit to it, we can introduce greater competition into the insurance market so you have the opportunity to shop plans across state lines, because like in any market, more choice for consumers will drive down prices and drive up quality. We can do that to lower premiums while standing up for core protections for American citizens who have pre-existing conditions. There was a little boy out at a campus launch, he's up on his father's shoulders getting ready to knock on some doors just a few weeks ago. And I walked up, he was about 7 years old. Turns out he has a heart condition, he was born with it. It's treatable. If the family can afford the health insurance to cover it. And they can't right now because there's a prohibition on price discrimination against Americans with pre-existing conditions. But if this bill that just passed the House, passed the Senate, there will be no limit on the increase in premiums for that family. And if they can't get their little boy insured, they'll be out tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars per year out of pocket. And if they can't afford that, their son may die. I think for career politicians in D.C., it's become a matter of abstract statistics, but there are real human consequences. And I will bear those real human consequences in mind when advocating for you in Congress if I have the privilege of serving.
Georgia is one of two states with a minimum wage lower than the federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour for employees not covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. What is your plan to address minimum wage for Georgians?
Well, the minimum wage should be a living wage. Could make it so. A reasonable proposal, I think, would be to index it to the cost of living. And I will work, I hope we can find bipartisan common ground in this Congress to increase the minimum wage if I'm elected. And I haven't heard that commitment from my opponent.
What kind of leadership would you bring to Washington to say to the powers that be to stop these Jim Crow era rules and laws against voters in the United States of America?
Thank you for the question, Michelle. Well, it is an old story. It's a familiar story. And as I said, it is an open secret that much of this legislation has got nothing to do with the integrity of our elections and everything to do with keeping people from exercising their right to vote. And I will speak out directly and candidly against it. And I will hold the Attorney General accountable if he fails to enforce the Voting Rights Act, as I said. And I will oppose any bill moving through Congress with the cynical intent of disenfranchising American voters.
Thank you, sir. Let's do it like this, because there's no line, there's no microphone. I have the microphone. So if you raise your hand, let me come to you. We want to make sure you're on the microphone. If you have a question for John Ossoff, let's go right here. And we want to make sure you get in the microphone because there is a recorded feed.
Thank you for coming tonight. One of my concerns follows up on your healthcare comment, in that Georgia is 49 out of 50 states in Medicaid spending, and if the ACA law that's been passed by the House goes forward, we will be hammered and capped, and we will lose for our age, blind, and disabled population significantly. It will be horrible.
Thank you for the question, ma'am. And I would note also that Georgia is one of those states that declined to accept help in making sure that low-income children, low-income Georgians, get the health care that they need. And it's a disgrace. There is plenty of room for belt tightening in Washington, and anyone who has worked there, and I have, knows that. There is waste throughout the federal budget. On my website, I've identified nearly $600 billion in waste that I believe can be cut over a 10-year period so that we can set the right priorities. But I don't think that it's consistent with this community's values to balance the books on the backs of low-income children low-income people who lack health care, seniors, the most vulnerable and marginalized people in society. I don't think that this budget is consistent with this community's values, and I oppose it. Thank you for your question.
My name is John Wyden. I've been active since I was a teenager. And everybody knows that the insanity of not signing on for Paris Accords could be a disaster. We all know that. So what is there about the process that we can turn that around as quickly as possible, even if Trump isn't impeached? Because obviously, this is a matter of only two nations. Syria and so we've got to do something about this. It's like the CDC. Now we all know the conclusion of what happened in 20 years.
Thank you for the question, sir. And I agree with our military, our intelligence community, and peer-reviewed science that climate change is a major threat to our prosperity, to our security. If folks won't listen to the military, the intelligence community, and the overwhelming consensus of scientists, then their head is deep in the sand. Furthermore, as you know, sir, in Paris, for virtually the first time, China and India, two major competitors, through strong U.S. negotiating, agreed to accept responsibility along with the United States and other industrialized countries to reduce carbon emissions. What we're seeing right now in Washington, as I see it, is a proposal to let them off the hook. It took decades of tough-minded negotiation to bring those economic competitors to carry some of the load. And if we walk away now, they'll return to free riding. As for what can be done, winning this election would send a pretty strong message.
East side, John. East side. East side. There you go. East side. Right here, John. All right. So this has to be the last question because I want to make sure everyone has an opportunity to engage John directly. But let's go ahead and give him a round of applause. Thank you.
Good evening, John. My name is Cheryl Scales, and I voted for you today. One of the things that I love to hear you talk about and expand on more for us here is your vision for the platform around a new economy. There's a lot of darkness, but when you talk about that, that's jobs, that's hope, that's income. Can you give us more insight and let us hear your voice in real time?
Thank you for the question. I'm honored to have your support. We all agree on the need for greater opportunity and prosperity here in Metro Atlanta. It unites us. I think that's why 15 to 20% of Republicans in this district are supporting my campaign, because I'm focused on how we can bring more jobs and investment to this community, how we can attract more capital and clients to our entrepreneurs and small businesses, how we can become the Silicon Valley of the South. We can become a hub for venture capital, technological innovation, financial technology, biomedical technology, medical research. It just takes some vision and some will and some bipartisanship to do it. If we, as I was mentioning, cut wasteful spending in the federal budget so that we can set the right priorities, every dollar wasted is a dollar spent on the wrong priorities. We set the right priorities, higher education, college affordability, research and development. We can supercharge Metro Atlanta's economy, infrastructure, I mean, I think we know now, maybe better than we ever have, that Metro Atlanta's economy is in, infrastructure is in need of renewal. And that doesn't mean just bridges and highways and roads. That also means the kind of rapid transit alternatives that every great commercial city has. And when growing organizations globally or across the country are thinking about where to put new research centers, headquarters, and facilities, they expect that kind of infrastructure. And when talented young people here and across the country are thinking about where they want to work, where they want to contribute their talent and their energy, they expect that quality of life. So let's unite to raise our standard of living, to become more successful, more prosperous, healthier, together. We don't have to be fighting all the time. And I'm convinced that we share more in terms of values, and we share more in terms of our interests in this community than partisans in DC or folks on cable news would have us believe. It's not a mystery what a flourishing community looks like. It's one where there is opportunity for everyone, where prosperity is increasing, where new businesses are being created, people are innovating, where investment is coming in, where people are healthy. So let's focus on finding common ground to make this community into a community that is flourishing to its fullest potential, and stop fighting amongst ourselves and just get it done.
John is going to take a few moments to meet and greet each of you. Bishop Bruce, can you please come to close us in the benediction? John is going to take a few minutes to meet and greet each of you outside at his table. So once we're done with the benediction, if you would be so kind to line up at the table, he's going to shake your hand and possibly, if we hope, do a photo op as well. If we can get two of the volunteers to move this table, Calvin and the young professionals, why don't you give the young professionals a round of applause? All of our young people are not looking this way. All of our young people are not doing things that are bad. We appreciate the Urban League and the young professionals who are showing up. Immediately following the benediction, all of you that are lined up here, we're going to line up in front of the banner. John is going to take a photo, and he's going to meet everyone else outside by his table. Please receive Bishop Ruth Smith.
Amen. Come on and give God praise for such an awesome night. It's been very informative, and you guys have been wonderful. And to Pastor Sabrina and all who made this possible, give God praise for them. Shall we stand just a moment? May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you, and may the Lord make his face to shine upon you, and may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, and may the Lord be gracious unto you, and give you peace and prosperity all the days of your life. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the people of God said amen.
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 Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Friendly reminder, you can start lining up at John's table if you are here to meet and greet. And for the others, if you would line up in front of the banner.